The opinions of Lincolnshire are pretty much standard, especially from those who have never even set foot in the county.
It's all flat, isn't it? Isn't it all farming?
I've never had a reason to go. It's a bit out of the way, isn't it?
And yes, those statements do have a small amount of credibility to them. But do they paint the real picture?
Absolutely not. In fact, you'll find they only just scratch the surface.
So as a proud yellow belly, I'd love you to come and join me as we break through those misconceptions and reveal the real reasons why the world really does need Lincolnshire.
So, in order to help set up and paint the best picture of the county, we really need to skim through its humble beginnings. Lincolnshire's history dates back to beyond 300 BC, when the first settlers arrived in its capital, Lincoln. And these original settlers were known as the Celtic tribe Coritani. Years later, during the reign of Emperor Nero, Lincoln was being developed into this grand Roman legionary fortress. And soon their mark was being left all across the city. The name itself, Lincoln, is actually shortened from its Latin equivalent, Lindum Colonia, which derives from the prominent pool beneath the city. This today can be seen as the Brayford waterfront, England's oldest inland harbour. Formal history in the county dates back to around 60 AD, as soon as the Romans learned of Lincoln's importance. Now, the most famous monument that still remains is Newport Arch behind me in the Balegate area of the city. Today, it is the oldest arch in the country still to welcome traffic. And further Roman examples can be found close by. It wasn't long before Lincoln was recognised as the Romans' main hub for the country, and this was reflected in the building of two major roads that would connect the city to the other main parts of the country. These two roads would be aligned through Lincoln until finally separating around the area of the Guildhall. Ermine Street, known today as the A1, would connect the city to powerhouses York and London, passing through other Roman Lincolnshire settlements such as Ancaster. Whereas the Foss Way, today the A46, would connect Lincoln to the major southwest city of Exeter.
Now, it was not only the roads that were crucial to the Romans, but the canal system used for drainage and irrigation, and later transportation. Now, here at Foss Dyke Canal, this was the first to be developed in Britain by the Romans in 50 AD.
And ever since that time, Lincolnshire's canals and rivers have remained a key part of the county's infrastructure. Did you know? Gainsborough once ruled the country.
Yes, incredibly, Gainsborough was once the capital of England, albeit very briefly. Now, in 1013, King Sven Forkbeard, a Danish king, defeated Ethelred the Unready and made his way along the River Trent to base his operations here at Gainsborough. His headquarters was Gainsborough Castle, which has now been replaced by the Old Hall. His reign lasted just 37 days when he died after being thrown from his horse here at nearby Thonoke Park. Realising Lincoln's growing importance and strategic positioning on the hill, William the Conqueror had decided it was to be a location to build one of his main fortresses. In 1068, following his successful invasion of England, he ordered the building of Lincoln Castle on the site of the previous Roman fortress. And the city once again became an important asset. Of Lincoln Castle lies one of the most important documents in human history. Written in 1215, its words planted the seeds for democracy and freedoms that we know in the world today. And so, lurking beyond the prison walls, guarded safely inside a small vault, it would be revealed as the Magna Carta. This legal document, otherwise known as the Great Charter, was effectively created to settle a quarrel, and in fact rebellion, between King John and the country's barons. It was a realisation that in order to save his throne, he would have to come to some sort of truce with them. So, on the 15th of June 1215, the king and the rebellious barons met on neutral territory at Runnymede to sign the historic document. Present at the time was the Bishop of Lincoln, Hugh of Wells, who returned with the Lincoln copy. Today, one of only four surviving in the world. Its author was Lincolnshire's very own Archbishop of Canterbury at the time, Stephen Langton, who acted as mediator between the two parties, and he was born here at Langton by Ragby, just 10 miles east of Lincoln.
Visible in one of the windows at St. Giles Church is a stained glass portrait dedicated to him.
Many of the laws that we use today originate from this small piece of medieval parchment, most notably to guarantee the rights of all individuals to justice and a fair trial.
Additional statements can be found legally relevant in today's society.
The Magna Carta has been described as the greatest constitutional document of all time, providing foundation for such things as the American Constitution and Declaration of Independence.
The 800-year-old Charter is the cornerstone of civil liberty and constitutions in many other countries, including New Zealand and India, leaving legendary figure Mahatma Gandhi to declare, "It is, in my opinion, the Magna Carta of our liberty in this land." And while standing in the dock facing a lifetime in prison, it was to be the Magna Carta that Nelson Mandela would recite.
Its key links and connections to Lincoln means the area is commonly referred to as Magna Carta City.
Born to entertain.
We begin in the tiny hamlet of Somersby on the edge of the Lincolnshire Wolds, where one of Britain's greatest writers and poets was born. Described as the great voice of Victorian England, Alfred Lord Tennyson was born here at the Rectory in 1809. His father, George, was the local rector here at St. Margaret's Church, which was also the place where Tennyson was baptised. Now, some of his most famous poems include The Charge of the Light Brigade, In Memoriam, and The Lady of Shalott. Several of Tennyson's poems were actually based on his childhood here in Somersby, one particular one being The Brook.
For men may come and men may go, but I go on forever.
One of Tennyson's poems, The Palace of Art, was based on his early visits here to nearby Gumby Hall. A number of his famous phrases are still recognisable today, including, "'Tis better to have loved and lost than to never have loved at all."
"'And theirs is not to reason why, theirs is but to do or die."
As poet laureate of Great Britain and Ireland, one of his greatest admirers was Queen Victoria, who was said to have found great comfort in his work after the death of her husband, Prince Albert.
Prince Albert himself was such a fan that when on his deathbed, he would request his own personal autograph from Tennyson.
Lincolnshire may not have a frontman Freddie Mercury or even a king of rock and roll like Elvis, but behind the scenes, it's a different story.
And when it comes particularly to songwriting, we have it in abundance. Record breakers, in fact, as shown by our first examples.
Bernie Taupin was born here at Flatter's Farm in 1950, just outside the village of Alnwick near Sleaford. When Bernie was 8 years old, the family relocated here to Maltkiln Farm in Ownby by Spittle, a village just near Market Raisin.
Spending his youth and teenage years here, his passion for writing would see him scribble down ideas amongst his surroundings.
And in a bedroom in the cottage right behind me was where some of the most famous lyrics in the world were created. Home to Lincolnshire's premier racecourse, the next chapter in the songwriter's life would take place at Market Raisin.
At the age of 15, Bernie left school and started work as a trainee in the print room of the local newspaper, the Lincolnshire Standard, with aspirations of becoming a journalist. In 1967, Taupin's life would ultimately change forever when he answered an advert seeking talent for Liberty Records. Elton John would answer the same ad, and there began one of the most famous and successful collaborations in music history. The pair have to date generated 40 top 10 hits, earning more than 30 gold and platinum albums together. Boy, if I did. And they have the biggest selling single of all time with Candle in the Wind 97, a tribute to Princess Diana.
A big influence to one of his most famous songs was said to have been based on his youth experiences at the Aston Arms in the marketplace.
The song, Saturday Night's All Right for Fighting, would also invoke memories of his time at Boston's Glidodrome. The two would become the closest of friends, with Elton even making an appearance in Market Raisin as Bernie's best man during his wedding at the local church in 1971. Burnley was inducted into the Songwriters Hall of Fame in 1992 and even won an Oscar in 2020 for his songwriting in the biopic Rocketman.
Another one of Lincolnshire's unsung songwriters was Rod Temperton, who was born and grew up here in Cleethorpes. He would later go on to make global musical history. Well, like Bernie Taupin, Rod Temperton was educated here in Market Raisin at De Aston School, where he gained much of his musical influences.
After joining the disco group Heatwave, he would soon try his hand at songwriting, creating popular hits like the song Boogie Nights and Groove Line for the band. His creativeness would help other artists, including Gimme the Night for George Benson and Always and Forever, released by Luther Vandross. His disco flair would soon bring him to the attention of producer Quincy Jones and ultimately Michael Jackson. There he would write songs on the King of Pop's first album, Off the Wall, including the hit Rock With You. More crucially than that would be Rod's songwriting talents on the second project, Thriller, which included penning and naming the title track, still the biggest selling album of all time. Today, a blue plaque on Grimsby Road in Cleethorpes, where he was born, commemorates his unforgettable musical achievements. In a different kind of songwriting, Lincolnshire's Charles Wesley, brother to John, wrote one of the most popular Christmas carols, Hark the Herald, in 1739. Today, one of the country's brightest stars is pop sensation Ella Henderson, who grew up in Tetney. When it comes to acting in films, the county boasts versatile Oscar winner Jim Broadbent, who grew up in Halton-cum-Beckering, and his family have a theatre named after them in nearby Wickenby. Joan Plowright, nominated for an Emmy and two BAFTAs, and winner of two Golden Globes and a Tony Award, was born in Brigg, and was famously married to Lord Olivier. She also has a theatre in her name in Scunthorpe. Also linked to the county is legendary late Oscar-winning actor John Hurt. Star of The Elephant Man and Alien, he was educated in both Lincoln and Grimsby. Another star of the big screen is Lincoln's Colin McFarlane, who appeared in Chris Nolan's Batman trilogy. On a side note, legendary comic duo Laurel and Hardy were no strangers to the county, and made several appearances to the area around Grantham and its Guildhall. They spent time as well nearby at the Plough Inn at Barkston, which just happened to be ran by Stan's sister, Olga. The county boasts many stars of TV too. BAFTA award winners Jennifer Saunders, heralding from Sleaford, and Sheridan Smith from Epworth. Then there's the royal family's Liz Smith from Scunthorpe, the Peep Show's Robert Webb from Boston, and Strictly's Kevin from Grimsby. In broadcasting, the much-loved Nicholas Parsons hailed from Grantham, and BBC's Hard Talk presenter Stephen Sacker from Spilsby. Authors are here too, including Inspector Morse creator Colin Dexter, who derived from Stamford. And interestingly, although not born here, George Eliot's famous novel The Mill on the Floss was based on a visit to Gainsborough in 1859.
And many stars from the world of sport also call Lincolnshire home.
That includes Olympian and twice World's Strongest Man Jeff Capes from Holbeach, golf major winner and successful Ryder Cup captain Tony Jacklin from Scunthorpe, and Liverpool and England's three-time European champion winning goalkeeper Ray Clements from Skegness. Talking of football, Grimsby Town will be one of the first big breaks for legendary manager Bill Shankly. And one of Boston United's most famous supporters is commentator John Motson, who was baptised in the town and grew up watching the team as a youngster. From an Olympic point of view, Lincoln's Georgie Twigg grabbed gold with the UK ladies hockey team at Rio in 2016, a place where Grimsby Paralympian Holly Arnold won gold in the javelin and Lincoln-born Sophie Wells in the equestrian sport of dressage. Situated close to the cathedral, a postbox was painted gold to celebrate her success. When it comes to record breakers, Lincolnshire's got that covered too. Back in 1951, Scartho's Brenda Fisher broke the women's world record for swimming the English Channel in just 12 hours and 42 minutes. Popular TV presenter and celebrity speedster Guy Martin holds Guinness World Records driving the fastest tractor, the fastest speed in a soapbox, and the highest speed on a wall of dead. And then there's Grantham's adventurer Ross Edgeley, who in 2018 became the first person to swim around the coast of Britain. Yes, all 1,780 miles of it. Well, it may sound too good to be true, but there is a genuine belief that legendary filmmaker Walt Disney's ancestors came from the village. So much so that he would make a personal appearance with his family to the Lincolnshire village in 1949. Part of his time was to explore the local church for his descendants' gravestones, and afterwards spending time mixing with locals, even enjoying a game of darts in the local pub. His ancestors were said to have moved over from France years before to settle in the village. In 2019, a further possible connection had been unearthed in Quadring near Spalding. And then finally, I can proudly mention my dad, Maurice Bird, who was working as scriptwriter for King of Comedy Ken Dodd during the 70s and 80s. The Greatest Britain. Now, if you're still not convinced about Lincolnshire's role in the world, I brought you to Colstowith, a village just near Grantham, to hopefully sway you. Regarded as one of the world's greatest ever scientists, one of Lincolnshire's most famous sons, Sir Isaac Newton, was born here at Woolsthorpe Manor on December the 25th, 1642. Newton, born 3 months after the death of his father, a prosperous farmer, was brought up initially by his mother, then later by his paternal grandmother. Lodging with a local apothecary, his education began in the neighbouring town and was soon introduced to the fascinating world of science. Now, he was educated here at King's School in Grantham, and during a difficult childhood, he found solace in his books. In 1661, he was admitted to Trinity College in Cambridge, but the university would close 4 years later as a precaution against the Great Plague which ravaged London. He returned to Woolsthorpe to stay with his mother. Soon intrigued, he would set about creating and practicing a variety of experiments based on his education. From his bedroom window, he began to make incredible breakthroughs to do with optics, concluding that a composite of all colours in the spectrum actually make up white light. This would later help him to create the reflecting telescope. Time would also be spent discovering a new type of mathematics called calculus, all by the age of 24.
But it would be events here in 1666 that would cement his place in history. As legend has it, the sight of an apple falling from this very tree would lead to some of the world's greatest discoveries, developing Newton's theories on gravity and laws of motion.
This would all form the basis for modern physics. A series of interactive experiments on display at his home today highlight these remarkable achievements. For all to participate in, both young and young at heart. Newton died in 1727 and was buried in Westminster Abbey, but his name continues to reverberate around his hometown. His remarkable expertise and discoveries in not just gravity and motion, but optics and calculus, even his role and vision as Master of the Royal Mint, show that his impact on the world cannot be overstated.
If it were not for Sir Isaac Newton, the world would be very different. And so he's rightfully regarded as one of the greatest Britons that ever lived.
Royal Associations.
Remember our old Danish king Sven Forkbeard? Well, he wasn't the only king to have ties with a county. One was actually born in Lincolnshire. Henry Bolingbroke, or Henry IV, was named so because of his birth here at Bolingbroke Castle in 1367. Son of John of Gaunt, he would go on to rule the country in difficult times for 14 years.
His own son, Henry V, would take over the crown. And both their lives would be of extreme fascination to Shakespeare, who would write historical plays about them. Time now for our second trip back to Gainsborough's Old Hall, and it wouldn't be our last.
The Old Hall was built in 1460 by Thomas Burrough. Now, one of his descendants, Edward, married the future Queen of England, Catherine Parr, and they lived here in 1529.
Part timber framed and mostly brick built, the hall is one of the best preserved medieval manor houses in the country. Its guest list included King Richard III in 1483. But more notably than that was the arrival of King Henry VIII and his fifth wife, Catherine Howard, in 1541, whilst on their way to York.
A short while after, the couple moved 20 miles north to here in Curtin in Lindsey, and they would have worshipped at St Andrew's Church behind them. Now, interestingly enough, just after the birth of Newton, a hugely significant event was taking place further north in the county near the town of Horncastle. It was the time of the English Civil War, and in 1643, right here, was the Battle of Winsby.
It would last just 12 hours, but that period of time would have significant repercussions.
The date was October the 11th, and Royalist cavaliers were advancing from Lincoln, ready to take back Bolingbroke Castle. But standing in their way on this particular high ground were the parliamentary roundheads led by Oliver Cromwell.
Oliver Cromwell was an English general and statesman who led the Parliament of England's armies against King Charles I during the English Civil War.
battle soon commenced, and in this area known as Slash Hollow, suddenly Cromwell's horse was shot from underneath him, sending him flying to the ground. He got back to his feet, only to find himself staring back at the barrel of an enemy gun. But in the nick of time, a fellow roundhead took out the perpetrator and stopped an event that would have surely changed the course of history.
Cromwell would go on to become Lord Protector, and the result was the creation of our modern constitutional monarchy, limiting the monarch's power while still remaining as a figurehead. It also allowed freedom of speech in Parliament. Birth of America.
So not a lot happens here. Well, what if I told you it's pretty much where the story of the United States of America began?
Queen Elizabeth I was on the throne, and Protestant non-conforming religious beliefs were rife in England. A small group of separatists and Puritans from Gainsborough in Lincolnshire and Scrooby in Nottinghamshire had come to believe their Christian faith was now incompatible to the Church of England.
In 1596, the hall was sold to a William Hickman, who supported the separatists and allowed them to worship here in secrecy.
Disenchanted with the current way of preaching, their alternative practices were soon becoming common knowledge, and so a clampdown had begun on these gatherings.
The separatists were vilified and treated as traitors, so in 1607 they decided to flee to Holland to escape persecution and pursue their religious beliefs more freely. Two boats would be waiting for the groups at the town of Boston behind me. From there, they would travel along this river and across the North Sea. Although the Gainsborough crew were successful, the Scrooby separatists were not quite so fortunate. In fact, they were betrayed by their ship's captain right here at Scotia Creek, just a few miles downriver, and arrested.
A memorial stands to reflect on and mark the events.
Soon after their capture, they were imprisoned in the cells at Boston Guildhall. Later released, they would return to Scrooby penniless. After being released from the Guildhall, the Scrooby group would make a second attempt to cross, this time further up the coast here in Immingham. This would prove to be successful, as detailed in a further memorial.
After several peaceful years in Holland, they decided to sail for the New World in search of a better life. Sailing from Plymouth on the 16th of September 1620, they would ultimately reach Massachusetts after an arduous two-month voyage. Eventually, they would be known as the Pilgrim Fathers.
In 1630, a further group of Lincolnshire Puritans left Boston for America, founding a new settlement in Massachusetts. They would name it after their hometown.
by the Reverend John Cotton, vicar of St. Botolph's in Boston, and a man who had become spiritual leader of the church-dominated state. Of Boston, Massachusetts would later play a key role in the nation's history with their Tea Party protest. The first steps to a declaration of independence in 1776. Meanwhile, Boston, England pays its own homage, befitting of its fundamental history with America.
Now, when you hear the name Captain John Smith, some people may relate it to a certain Pocahontas. But as we explore his birthplace, the truth is, there's a lot more to him. Captain John Smith was born and baptised here in Willoughby near Alford in 1580. And in the local church, there are various references to his life. Would go on to play a crucial role in establishing and training the very first English settlement in Jamestown, Virginia, USA, where he would later go on to become governor.
Connections between the village of Willoughby and the state of Virginia remain strong.
Now, in addition, his exploration of the Chesapeake Bay area allowed him to successfully map the coast, a coast to which he would later name as New England.
A world of exploration.
When it comes to exploration, pretty much nothing can match Lincolnshire's list of heavyweights and icons that have not only discovered, but transformed vast areas of the world. Our first stop is Revesby, where a young Joseph Banks spent much of his childhood roaming around his father's estate. And so it would be amongst these very grounds that he would gain his passion for plants and nature.
In 1771, he would famously join Captain Cook on board the HMS Endeavour, sailing around the Americas and the Pacific, bringing together a team to collect plants, fish, birds, animals, and insects that were all instrumental in understanding the natural world.
After returning from Australia with Captain Cook, he would come back to Revesby to inherit his father's estate. And from there, he would get involved in many great projects that would benefit Lincolnshire for many years to come. One of which was his active role in the development of the canals and field drainage across the Fens, which massively improved the county's infrastructure.
In 1778, he was elected president of the Royal Society, an office he held for 41 years. And as advisor to King George III, he would go on to develop one of the most important botanical institutions in Britain, Kew Gardens.
He was also Lord of the Manor here in Horncastle and helped set up a local dispensary for those who couldn't afford medical treatment in the town.
He was in fact a very busy man and even held the title of High Sheriff of Lincolnshire, also owning a townhouse along the High Street. As explained at the Joseph Banks Centre, he is also credited with introducing tea to India, breadfruit to the Caribbean, and has over 170 types of Banksia named after him.
The tribute garden here celebrates a collection of his species. Now, the next giant of exploration was born here in Donington in 1774.
Son of a surgeon, also Matthew, and mother Susanna, Flinders, in his own words, said he would be induced to go to sea against the wishes of his friends from reading Robinson Crusoe.
Captain Matthew Flinders grew up in the village and was educated at the local school. Now, Captain Flinders would be the second person to circumnavigate the New Holland area, but it would be his voyage that would map it clearly and identify it first as a continent. He would also give it the name as we know it today, Australia.
His contribution to the continent has left enduring Lincolnshire footprints all over the country, particularly in the south, where he is considered to be the main explorer. Numerous memorials have been created in his honour. Not to mention his own named list of islands that descended from his county origins. In 2019, news was announced that the remains of one of England's most distinguished seafarers would be returning home to Donington, the place of his birth. George Bass, a surgeon and explorer, came from Aswoodby near Sleaford and was a good friend of Flinders. So much so that Flinders would name the famous Bass Strait in his honour.
I'm humbled to reveal that the final great of exploration, Sir John Franklin, just happens to hail from my hometown of Spilsby. In an attic above his father's shop, Franklin was born in the town centre in 1786, and from the age of 12 he would seek a life of seafaring that would take him on several expeditions around the world.
Related to Matthew Flinders, he would join his older cousin as midshipman on important voyages around Australia. He was present in the Battle of Trafalgar and would later become Lieutenant Governor of Tasmania. But most importantly, he would be remembered for his Arctic voyages to map through northern Canada and the Northwest Passage.
His final voyage would end in tragedy when he died in 1847, but his legacy shows an immense contribution to the route as we know it today.
It would in fact be the subsequent searches to find Franklin that eventually completed the last part of the route. In recognition of his achievements in exploration, various countries have dedicated many sites to his name. And not to mention in his hometown. Time now to delve into a collection of truly milestone feats the county has enjoyed, which most people are blissfully unaware of.
For thousands of years, the pyramids of Giza stood as mankind's tallest structures. But that would all change in 1072 when work began on constructing a great cathedral. After several restarts, its completion in 1311, measuring a staggering 525 feet, meant that Lincoln Cathedral had just been crowned the new tallest building in the world. It would remain the world's tallest building for 238 years, only relinquishing its crown when a lightning strike brought down its central spire in 1549. Leading the way for women. Our next stop is Grantham to unveil a couple of significant firsts for Britain. It was above this grocery shop, owned by her father, that Margaret Hilda Thatcher was born in 1925.
She would attend the local girls' school before studying chemistry in Oxford. An MP in 1959, she was eventually elected Prime Minister 20 years later, the first female in turn to do so. Dubbed the Iron Lady, she would navigate the country through the Falklands War and lead her party to three election wins, more than anyone else in the 20th century.
Her legacy continues to defy opinion, but there's no doubting her impact on the world stage and her place in history as Britain's first female Prime Minister. In 1915, Edith Smith became the first policewoman in the United Kingdom, serving from this very police station.
Granted full powers of arrest, she walked the town streets, dealing primarily with cases where women were involved. As a true role model, she would later speak at conferences around the country on women's policing.
Her pioneering role would pave the way for future female officers.
Leading the way in engineering.
Now, in truth, this next magnificent feat can only really be half accredited to the county of Lincolnshire, that being the mighty Humber Bridge. Now, it was opened in 1981 by Her Majesty the Queen, and at the time, it was the world's longest single-span suspension bridge.
Travelling its full length and a whopping 1,410 metres later, it joins with Hesel in the East Riding of Yorkshire. Work began in 1973, taking 8 years to complete. The concrete towers are 155 metres tall and were built to be 36 millimetres further apart from each other at the top than at the bottom to allow for the curvature of the earth. In 2017, the Humber Bridge was given Grade 1 listed status by Historic England, and it remains the longest in the world that can be crossed on foot or by bicycle. Before this time, it would have been necessary to take a ferry across the river, one of which, the Tattershall Castle, now resides as a floating restaurant viewing the south bank of London.
Now, did you know there's enough cable on that bridge to wrap itself almost twice around the earth?
Leading the way spiritually.
John Wesley, one of England's greatest spiritual leaders, was born here at the old rectory in Epworth in 1703. He later founded the Methodist Church. Methodism would continue to grow throughout the world, and in fact one of the oldest remaining chapels that's still in use is here in Wraithby near Spilsby, and was actually opened by Wesley in 1779.
Chad Farrer was a British Anglican priest from Barton-upon-Humber. And as a social activist, in 1953 he founded the Samaritans, the world's first crisis hotline. Pinchbeck's Key Market store, where Morrison's now stands, was chosen to host the historic moment when the country's first barcode on a packet of Melrose tea bags was scanned back in October 1979.
Tucked away in the Lincolnshire Wold at over 350 metres high, the Belmont Mast was at one time the tallest structure in the European Union.
This was up until 2009 when a section was removed. Today it still beats the Eiffel Tower and the Shard in London by at least 30 metres. And talking of heights, in the bustling market town of Louth, St James Church is the tallest parish church in the country, with a spire of 293 feet. Then there's also the tallest windmill in Britain, down amongst the fens in Moulton. And if that's not enough, you can then head across to Heckington and visit the only working eight-sailed windmill in the world. Michael Fole, born in Lincolnshire, was the second Briton in space and the first to perform a spacewalk. Appropriately, he has a street named after him in his hometown. Before Glastonbury and before Woodstock in America, in fact before them all, came Spalding Barbecue 67. Yes, it's true, this event was the first rock festival in the world, showcasing up-and-coming act Jimi Hendrix in the Tulip Auction Room. Also on the list that day were little-known artists Pink Floyd and Cream, featuring a certain Eric Clapton. Hendrix would later stay at the Red Lion in the centre of town. On November 1st, 1925, an historic event took place at Crowland Abbey. The sound of the bells on BBC radio became the first ever church bells to be transmitted over the airwaves. The Abbey is also claimed to have been the first church in England and amongst the first in the world to have a tuned peal or ring of bells. And on top of that, at 90 feet, the pole or ropes are the longest in England. The county even hosts the oldest oak tree in Britain, the Beaufort Oak, which resides in Manthorpe near Bourne. And with a girth of almost 13 metres, it's also said to be the thickest. Dating from 1611, Alford's Manor House is the largest thatched house in the UK. And with a diameter of 16 feet, the clock at Coningsby St Michael's Church is the largest one-handed clock in the country. Along the east coast lies the popular resort of Skegness. And it would be here that the British holiday would be changed forever. In 1936, entrepreneur Billy Butlin decided to revolutionise the holiday industry, aiming to make the British seaside break accessible to all. His hope was to create a place of colour and happiness with quality activities and entertainment. And the first camp was opened here in Skegness in 1936. He would be a leading pioneer in the world of service. Not only that, but he was also the person to introduce the popular Dodgems amusement ride to the UK. Did you know? Many famous stars began their career at Butlin's, from Cliff Richard and Benny Hill to Ted Rogers, Jimmy Tarbuck, Des O'Connor and Stephen Mulhern. Oh, and I was even there too. And finally, Butlin's would also play a part in the creation of the most successful band in history. Ringo Starr was actually talent spotted whilst performing at the camp in Skegness by none other than John Lennon. Ruling the skies. Travel to any corner of Lincolnshire and the one common thread is aviation. With its big skies, large open spaces and array of air bases both active and historic, it's easy to understand the county's special relationship with flying. Inventions, daring display teams, wartime history and memorials can all be counted as some of Lincolnshire's most treasured assets. One of the county's most prominent places, Bomber Command Centre in Lincoln, is home to the UK's tallest war memorial and helps reflect on the names of almost 58,000 men and women who lost their lives. Now, each part of the UK played a key role in the success of World War II. Due to its flatness, Lincolnshire was able to amass over 100 airfields, more than any other place in the country. These in main were used by bomber aircraft, which were set to disable German operations. The Peace Garden's native trees mark each of the county's operational stations during the war. The county's service in the Battle of Britain has long been admired, and with it emanates many heroic stories that still live deep in the memory. One mission in particular, with its roots deep in the county, would embrace the country's daring and courageous spirit. On the 16th of May 1943, Operation Chastise was to be a significant attack on a series of German dams by the Royal Air Force. Now, number 617 Squadron, later referred to as the Dam Busters, would use purpose-built bouncing bombs developed by Barnes Wallace, and their headquarters was right here at the Petwood Hotel in Woodall Spa. The exploits of Guy Gibson and his team during Operation Chastise can be found all over the county, including RAF Scampton, where the planes would originally take off from. Today, Scampton would be home to another iconic institution, recognised by their eye-catching trail of red, white and blue. Famous for their trademark formations and precision flying, the red arrows light up skies all over the world and particularly during national events. From 2022, they will make the short distance of 10 miles to base themselves at RAF Waddington. Today, Waddington is the main operating base for airborne intelligence aircraft, and from 1995 to 2014, it was also home to the RAF's largest air show. 12 miles south of Waddington, RAF Cranwell is known for its key role in training the country's best pilots. Doing so ever since its development as the world's first air academy in 1919. Notable attendees just happen to include Prince William and his father, Prince Charles. Lincolnshire's aviation history is retold through a variety of wonderful heritage sites that include Coningsby's Battle of Britain Memorial Flight, the We'll Meet Again Museum at Freeston, and the Aviation Centre at East Kirkby, with a tribute to the Dambusters and its special attraction, Just Jane. All this and more are the reasons why Lincolnshire is commonly known as Bomber County. Full of great ideas. Designed to save thousands of lives, one of the most significant inventions in warfare was created in Lincolnshire.
A stalemate had set in the First World War, and so in 1915, William Fosters of Lincoln had been tasked with manufacturing a vehicle that, as Churchill would put it, was equipped with caterpillar tracks to carry personnel.
Interestingly, the continuous caterpillar tracks part had already been invented by another Lincolnshire company, Hornsby and Sons of Grantham, in 1904.
The design concept came from the managing director of Fosters at the time, William Tritton, and engineer Walter Wilson. But the two men would lock themselves away in a room here at the White Hart Hotel, where they were able to focus on designing the new engineering feat that would help end the war.
With the plans drafted, its design went immediately into production. Fosters were told to have it ready for testing as soon as possible. Just 3 months later, it was ready to go, managing to pass all tests with flying colours.
The first prototype was nicknamed Little Willy, and soon the tank was introduced to the battlefield, breaking the deadlock, shortening the war, and therefore saving lives.
Lincoln had now been given another nickname, Tank Town. Without the tank, it's estimated that the war would have been dragged into the 1920s with thousands more lives lost. Tritton's name was heralded around the city. Today, an area has been dedicated to the former managing director on the original site of the William Fosters factory.
Frank Whittle was born in Coventry but would attend the cadet college here at RAF Cranwell in 1923. His ability was so outstanding that he was soon put forward for officer training. Now, to complete the course, his thesis was on future aircraft design, and he determined that to fly faster, a new kind of propulsion would be required, this in turn leading to the invention of the turbojet engine. The first jet-powered British plane took off from Cranwell's airstrip in 1941, thus changing aviation history. The aircraft was a Gloster's model and successfully piloted by Flight Lieutenant Jerry Sayer in a journey lasting 17 minutes. There came the moment that would change the way future generations would travel forever. And in other news, intelligence officer T.E. Lawrence, renowned for his role in the Arab Revolt, and whose story was dramatically retold in the epic film Lawrence of Arabia, spent a year stationed on his return at Cranwell. There he lodged at Lincoln and could often be found roaming the county on his beloved Brough motorbike. Now, another key invention here in Lincolnshire was undertaken by John Harrison, who grew up in Barrow-upon-Humber. Now, he would go on to invent the marine chronometer in nearby Brocklesby Park, which was crucial in solving the longitude problem during the 18th century for navigation at sea. Before Harrison's breakthrough invention, sailors would pretty much rely on dead reckoning. In other words, estimating their position by ship speed over a period of time. Basic compasses had been used, but it was still pretty much all a game of luck. The need for more accuracy was so sought after that the government would offer a £20,000 reward for anyone to solve the longitude problem. Harrison, a local clockmaker, set about finding a solution directly with a reliable clock. Able to cope with a boat's rocking and changing temperatures, he finally succeeded after several versions, producing the marine chronometer in 1737. Now accurately telling time at sea and therefore position, it saved countless lives and would be used in many famous voyages, including Captain Cook's expedition to the Pacific. And in his hometown in 2020, a statue was erected in his honour. On a side note, eagle-eyed fans of British comedy Only Fools and Horses would also recognise his worldly status. The auction item that ultimately made Del and Rodney millionaires, a John Harrison pocket watch. Another famous name was George Ball, who was born in the Pottergate area of Lincoln in 1815. He later went on to become the father of modern algebra. Widely heralded as one of the most influential mathematicians of the 19th century, George Ball's development of Boolean logic paved the way for the computer age and is regarded in hindsight as a founder of the field of computer science. American Claude Shannon applied Boolean logic in the 1930s to build the electrical circuits that would lead to modern computers. By the age of 19, he even found time to create a small school in his hometown. Today, internet search engines such as Google and Yahoo are all based on Boolean algebra. Some of the UK's most popular chocolate traditions would also owe a debt of gratitude to the county.
There's a rhythm and rush these days, where the lights don't move and the colors don't fade. Leaves you empty with nothing but dreams.
The Nation's Larder.
Now, key areas of Lincolnshire are certainly flat, and for two good reasons. Firstly, for providing the airfields that won the war, and secondly, for, well, feeding the country.
In fact, when you sit down to eat your next lunch, dinner or tea, there's a very good chance it's been produced here in the county.
If Kent is the garden of England, then Lincolnshire is certainly its larder.
Every day around the clock, the county's amazing team of farmers and helpers work tirelessly to put food on the nation's tables.
So much so that 20% of all grown foods come from Lincolnshire's lands.
Thanks to its rich silt soil, the terrain is perfect for producing vast quantities for us to enjoy.
It's the country's largest supplier of wheat, potatoes and cereals, and provides over 30% of all field vegetables.
That's produce ranging from cauliflower, broccoli, Brussels sprouts, leeks, kale, carrots, peas, onions, pumpkins, cabbages, you name it. All ready to provide you with that nourishing meal. And then there's the challenge of making sure the country remains bright.
Not only that, but here in the South Holland district, over 38% of all bulbs are grown.
Even a large flower parade would occupy the streets of Spalding for many years. Being the largest grower of potatoes and its record-breaking ports, even the national dish without Lincolnshire would be seriously under threat. Fishing along the county's northeast coast has been a fundamental part of the economy ever since its first dock opened in Grimsby in 1856. Since then, the industry would grow at an incredible pace. And by 1900, a tenth of all fish consumed in the UK was landed in the area.
On board the trawler here at the Heritage Centre, it gives a real insight to the fishing industry back in the day. In the 1950s, Grimsby had become the biggest fishing port in the world.
In recent times, the town has slowly been developed more towards food manufacturing and storage. And its port now plays a key role in receiving cargo, mainly in the auto industry.
Grimsby today remains Britain's busiest port, handling more tonnage than London.
Lincolnshire has not only led the way with large supplies of crops and fish, but also has, in its own right, a wonderful selection of award-winning delicacies. There's, of course, the nationally renowned Lincolnshire sausage. The handmade supreme champion cheese, the Lincolnshire poacher. The delicious plum loaf. And there's the traditional dish of salt pork with herbs known as stuffed chine. Hawkins of Grantham have continued to produce England's oldest commercially traded biscuit, the Grantham gingerbread, ever since it was first baked by William Eggleston in the town in 1740. a recipe so embedded in the town that it even provides the football team with their nickname. There are, in fact, so many surprising flavours found in Lincolnshire that in 2011, the county was voted the nation's food capital, pipping Cornwall to the title. And in other news, nestled amongst the fens near Freeston lies White Loaf Hall, so named because it was home to the country's first white loaf of bread, baked there in 1614. The beautiful county. For all its people and pioneers, there is something equally remarkable about Lincolnshire's stunning landscapes and architecture.
The county is full of spectacular buildings, including Tattershall Castle.
At Doddington Hall, the Christmas displays never fail to capture the imagination.
Now, Lincolnshire is home to one of the grandest stately homes in the country, and on the outskirts of Stamford, that being Burley House. Now, it's famous for its horse trials, but it was built in the 16th century for William Cecil, who was chief advisor to Queen Elizabeth I. In 1967, Stamford was awarded the first designated conservation area in England and Wales, protecting its character and over 600 listed buildings. And in 2013, the town was voted the best place to live in Britain by the Sunday Times. Further award winners include Lincoln's iconic Steep Hill, which won the Great Street Award in 2012. Full of boutique shops and tea rooms, it regularly sits in Britain's top five best loved streets. Towards the bottom of Steep Hill lies Jew's House. Built in 1150, it is recognised as one of the oldest townhouses in the country. Set up in 1710, the Spalding Gentlemen's Society was a place created to share knowledge. Notable members included Newton, Tennyson, Alexander Pope, and Joseph Banks. One of the few remaining sites left in Britain belonging to the military monks of the Crusades, the Knights Templars, can be found at Temple Brewer, where a precipitary tower remains standing also since 1150. Cinematic history is evident in the county with a very special picture house. One of the most magical places in the county is Kinnamer in the Woods. It's one of Britain's oldest cinemas and it's home to the country's oldest back screen projection. Thank you.
the county's wide-ranging landscapes and buildings mean big screen appearances have been in high demand.
Now, because of its stone buildings, Stamford has been used from film crews in such productions as Pride and Prejudice, who used St Mary Street behind me as Merton Village in the 2005 film.
The previously mentioned Burley House also played a starring role. And with its aviation history, Lincolnshire was an obvious choice for capturing the 1955 classic, The Dambusters. Including Gibraltar Point Nature Reserve near Skegness and Hemswell Cliff. In 2005, Lincoln itself would welcome major stars Tom Hanks, Sir Ian McKellen, Audrey Tautou, and director Ron Howard to film the popular Da Vinci Code. The movie's most dramatic scenes were set in and amongst Lincoln Cathedral. And Ron Howard would return to the county, specifically Cadwell Park in 2012 for the James Hunt biopic Rush, starring Chris Hemsworth.
Long Sutton in southeast Lincolnshire was once home to legendary highwayman Dick Turpin in 1737 for several months as he seeks refuge from London.
They made me think of you, they made me think of you. Under a tree in style.
Lincolnshire may be ideal for crops, land and runways, but it is time to dispel the myth that the county is all flat.
Welcome to the Lincolnshire Waltz.
Not only are the Wolds an outstanding area of natural beauty, but it's the highest point of land in the east of England. The county has all the seasons covered, and each one represents a magical time of year.
The first day of spring.
Or even a glorious summer's day. And let's be honest, nothing quite beats a Lincolnshire sunrise. Or even a crisp autumn walk. Not to mention a perfect winter scene.
And the festive season is most certainly taken care of. No matter what month, the Lincolnshire countryside is awash with dazzling colours. Thank you very much for joining me on this wonderful adventure, and I hope it's made you realise there's just so much more to Lincolnshire than meets the eye. And without it, the world, it just wouldn't be the same. For myself, Karl, bye for now.